Welcome everyone for this last lesson of Basics of Deep Learning. So we are starting lesson 7 on recurrent neural networks. So far we had a course overview, looked at PyTorch tensors and automatic differentiation, classification with deep learning, in particular with images, convolutional neural networks, to do feature extraction on images, then embedding layers on data loader with an example of collaborative filtering. The last lesson was on unsupervised learning tasks, and we looked at autoencoder and GANs. So today we will see the last main building blocks of networks, neural networks, namely recurrent neural networks, which are used when you have sequences or time series. So this means that you have a data set where there is one particular direction, which is namely the time. You have a notion of past and future. So the first thing I want to start with is we already saw one particular layers, which is very convenient for such 1D signal. So, and these are 1D convolutions. So we saw 2D convolutions for images, but you can apply 1D convolutions on a signal which are time series. And this is one well-known illustration due to DeepMind called WaveNet, where you are composing convolution as pictured on the right in order to generate audio file. Okay, but today we will look at the missing piece that we did not cover yet, which are recurrent neural networks. So here is a picture of the different architectures you can use with recurrent neural networks. So far we saw one-to-one things. So for example, you have an images, you pass it through your network and you get a label. Here we will mainly deal with, in this lecture, with this architecture, where as input you have a sequence. So let's say you have a sentence, or you have a time series, and each time step you have a new value, which is here, either the new value of your time series or the next word in your sentence, and you are passing it through your recurrent network, which is the picture in green here, and you want to do classification, for example. So you want, once you have read all the sequence, you want to predict its label. So there are other architectures which are possible. So for example, this one would correspond to, for example, a machine translation task where you put a sentence in French, for example, here, and you want to output the translation of this sentence in English here. So you read the sentence, pass it through your network, and then the network needs to output another sentence. In the practical for this lesson, you will deal with this many-to-many architecture, where you will have as an input time series corresponding to sensors on an engine. And you need, at each time step, to predict whether the engine will fail in and at what time. So you are making a first prediction given the first part of your sequence, then a second prediction which should be better than the first one once you have seen these two inputs of your sequence, and so on. This task will correspond to a task where you are producing a sequence from let's say an image. So it's like doing automatic caption of images. So you want to describe what is seen on this image. Okay, so recurrent neural networks are relatively easy to present with these small pictures, which are taken from this very nice post of Chris Ola. So just to make sure we all have the same vocabulary, the input is the x of t here, so t is the time, and h of t is what is called the hidden state of your network. So now you need to specify how you compute the new hidden state given previous hidden state and the current information you are receiving. And this is done thanks to a function with parameter w, f of w. So typically, this f of w will be a neural net where the w will be learned, the parameter will be learned. So here is a typical use of instantiation of this recurrence formula. So the new hidden state is computed by a linear layer applied to previous hidden state, another linear layer applied to the new information coming in, and passing this through a non-linearity, and most of the time it's a hyperbolic tangent. So here you see that this formula does not depend on the length of the sequence x of t. You will compute as many hidden states as required by the length of your sequence of vector x of t. Now, if you want to do, for example, a classification, like what we will do today, you take the last hidden state of your recurrent network, and you pass it through a linear layer to compute the y of t, and let's say you want to do, I don't know, if you want to do a regression, you just output this, and take MSE loss, for example. If you want to do classification, you pass it through softmax, as usual. Now, you see that you can unroll the representation of your network. So here, I did not modify at all the equations. It's just another way to get the what's happening in your network. And here I explicitly wrote x naught for the first input in my sequence, x1 for the second one, x2 for the third one, and so on. And xt is the last one. So you see that this hidden state is passed through this arrow from block to block. And at the end here, you have the last hidden state. If you want to make your prediction, you can forget all this hidden state, concentrate only on this one, and compute your output thanks to this equation. Okay, so the first thing you might wonder is how can you update the parameter of your function? So here you have linear activation. And it turns out that it's done automatically by PyTorch by what is called backpropagation through time. So you can see this picture here as a neural network where you have several different layers. But the main difference with what we have seen so far is that all these layers are sharing exactly the same weight given by these two matrices. Okay. Now you compute y, which is the prediction for your label. you compute your loss, and you can backpropagate the gradient through this graph and update. So you will have update your W matrices according to this gradient, and you will have an update corresponding to each gradient corresponding to each of these different steps. So you are summing all of them. So to be a little bit more concrete, I decided to take a very simple binary classification problem where you have a sequence. So here is the input, and you have a label which is either 0 or 1. So you see that in my simple example, I have sequences of varying lengths. So this one is short, this one is long, and I have only two digits in my sequence, plus one and minus one. Now, the label corresponding to this first sequence is one, the label corresponding to this second sequence is also one, but the label corresponding to this one is zero. So, can you guess what kind of task I'm asking the computer to solve here? Because remember, in a learning scenario, you only have access to a data set of training examples with the corresponding label. Okay, so to help you, I will rewrite this plus and minus one with parentheses like this, and now it should be clear what the task is. Each time I have a plus one, I'm opening a parenthesis, and each time I have a minus one, I'm closing a parenthesis. So you see that the class one corresponds to well-balanced or valid parenthesis string. Each time I'm opening, I'm just closing, opening and closing. So this is a valid string, a plus one. This one is not valid because here I'm closing twice and I just open once before that. So this is a zero. So you see that this is a very simple task. Actually, how would you solve this task? So it's a very simple task in computer science, and probably one good way to solve this task is by using what is called a stack. So what you need to do is each time you have an opening parenthesis, you will increase your stack, and each time you have a closing parenthesis, you will decrease your stack by one. Another way to say the same thing is basically you are counting the number of opening parentheses you have seen so far, and you are decreasing this number each time you see a closing parenthesis. Now, you have a valid parenthesis string if you never get a negative number. So you start from zero. The first parenthesis has to be opening, so you jump to plus one. And then each time you have an opening parenthesis, you add plus one. Each time you have a closing parenthesis, you decrease by one. So a valid sequence is one where you start from zero, you end up at the end at zero, meaning that you did close all your parentheses and you never crossed the boundary zero. So you see, it's a fairly simple task. And my goal here will be to try to solve this task not by an explicit algorithm, but by learning an algorithm thanks to recurrent neural networks. So I will make the life a little bit more interesting by adding colors to the parentheses. So here are the rules for labeling the colors with numbers. So with 10 colors, I will take numbers between 0 and 9, and opening parentheses will have the small integer from 0 to 4, and the closing one are between 5 and 9. And now a pair of opening and closing parentheses must satisfy that their sum is equal to 9. So for example, here, the 2 here is an opening parenthesis, the 0 is another opening parenthesis but with a different color, so this 0 cannot be closed by something else than a 9, so it's closed by this 9, and this 7 is closing these 2 over there. So you obtain this picture but with colors. And again, you have a class which is either a 1 if it's valid, or 0 if it's not valid. So I will leave you this as an exercise, how to solve this task. It's a bit more complicated than the case where you have only one type of parenthesis. And in particular, you can try to figure out what is the memory requirement of your algorithm for solving this task. So again, in this lesson, I will give as input sequences like this with the corresponding label, 0 or 1, to a recurrent neural network. Those sequences will have varying lengths. There is a clear direction of time. So this is a perfect setting for a recurrent neural network. And once I did read all my seconds, I can decide whether it's a valid or invalid parenthesis string. So let me start with probably the first recurrent neural network introduced by Hellman in the 90s. So there is only one small modification compared to what we have seen so far. It's Hellman used a ReLU activation, and now we move to hyperbolic tangent activation, as I said. But for the rest, it's exactly the simplest recurrent network you can think of, where you have two linear layers. The first one taking care of the additional information you receive at time step t. This one to transform the hidden state to the new one, you sum everything. There is only one bias because there is no need of bias for this one. Pass it through a nonlinearity and you get the new hidden state. Now again, in order to do your final prediction, you pass it through another linear layer. So here is a very simple implementation of this network in PyTorch. So you have three different matrices corresponding to this WXH, WHH, WHY. So remember that all these X and H are indeed vectors. So normally you cannot choose the dimension of your input. It's given to you by your problem. You can choose the dimension of your hidden state. So this will be the dim recurrent parameter here. So you see that this fully connected X to H is correspond to this matrix, H to H correspond to this matrix. I'm asking for no bias because I'm summing them. And then this H to Y is for this matrix. So here I'm defining my parameters, and the last thing we need to look at is the forward pass. So here what I'm doing is I'm first taking an initial state which is zero, and I'm picking the right dimension for h, which is the size of this dimension recurrent. And now I'm just implementing this as a for loop. So for this lesson, actually in this course, we will deal with recurrent neural networks. We will not use batches at all. So this x size of zero here is exactly the length of the sequence x. So I'm doing a for loop as many times as the number of input I have in my sequence, and then this is exactly corresponding to this equation. I'm updating the hidden state each time, and in a final step, I'm computing my y, this equation. Now for the training in our case, remember we have colored parentheses each time. So what we will do is we will translate this in a one hot vector. So if you have 10 colors, you have a vector of size 10 with only one corresponding to the particular color of your parentheses. And also, we do not consider batches, which are a little bit tricky with recurrent neural networks, because one of the points of using recurrent neural network is we want to deal with sequences of different lengths. So it's not completely obvious how to do a batch of sequences of different lengths. So for now, we will just do a batch of size 1 if you want, so passing only one sample, one sequence at a time. And this is what is done here. So I'm using cross entropy loss. This is a binary classification, Adam optimizer on my parameters. Then I'm generating my parentheses here, passing my input through my RNN, computing the loss with the given label, and do the usual optimization. So you see that there is no problem at all in PyTorch for doing backpropagation, even if there is a for loop in the forward over there. So it's done automatically by PyTorch. Now here are the results obtained for this simple network. So the first curve here is the loss, which is kind of decreasing. It's not exactly decreasing, and it's not very smooth compared to what we have seen so far. Here is the accuracy. So when you are close to one, it's better for your binary classification task. And you see also that the accuracy is not very smooth compared to what we have seen so far. And this is due to the fact that indeed here we are passing 1 second by 1 second through the network. So there is in this for loop here, each time I'm computing the gradient corresponding to only one sample and making one update. So there is no average at all over a batch. And this is the main reason why this curve for the loss and accuracy are not as smooth as what we have seen so far. But still, I mean, you see that the trend of the loss is decreasing, so you are learning something, and the accuracy tends to converge to something which is close to one. Okay. So let's discuss a first component that is very important with a recurrent neural network, namely the notion of gates. So the gate will be a component in your network to allow either the information to pass through or to cut the information at some point. And this is done in a very simple way by using what is called a sigmoid neural net layer. So just a sigmoid activation. So remember that a sigmoid will give you a number between 0 and 1. So a value of 0 will be, okay, let nothing go through, and a value of 1 will be, let everything go through. Now, this sigmoid function, you will use a standard as input, a linear layer. So this is written in a more formal way here. So you see that the first equation here is the same one, exactly the same one as this one. So this is a candidate, so this is not anymore the new hidden state, this is a candidate for your new hidden state based on previous hidden state and the current information. Now what we are adding here is the so-called forget gate. So this is a sigmoid layer, and the input of this sigmoid function is just two different linear layers applied to the current input and the previous hidden state. Okay, so these matrices are not the same. There is one matrix which is learned in order to determine whether you will use the forget gate or not, and one parameter in order to compute the new candidate for the hidden state. So now this is your candidate for the new hidden state. This is ZT, a real number between 0 and 1. And you compute your new hidden state by this very simple formula. You take the component-wise multiplication of this ZT with your vector. So you are multiplying all the components of HT minus 1 by this number. And if 1 minus z times the candidate for your new hidden state. So you see here that, for example, if zt is equal to 0, meaning that you completely remove this, you have here only this component, and this component is the candidate for your hidden state. You end up with exactly the same formula as for Hellman network. To the contrary, if zt is equal to 1, then you forget completely this, so you are not taking into account the new candidate for your hidden state, and you are passing all the information here. And of course, this z of t will be between 0 and 1, and how to decide whether it's a 0 and 1 is also learned thanks to the parameter of these matrices. So here is a PyTorch implementation of this simple gated RNN. So you see it's a little bit more complex than Hellman function, because now I have two more matrices corresponding to the forget gate over there, so which are this x to z and h to z. So these two matrices are new, but the rest are exactly the same. And now I'm doing the same thing as before. In the forward, I'm doing a for loop, initializing my hidden state to 0, then computing my forget gate, so this quantity over there, with a sigmoid, computing the candidate for my new hidden state, and finally computing my new hidden state by this very simple formula. So I'm doing this as many times as the length of my sequence x, and at the end I'm producing a label for my classification task. So here are the results. So again, I took the same parameters as before for the training. So in blue, you have the new curves corresponding to gated RNN. In orange, this is the previous Hellman RNN. So you see that the loss seems to be a bit smoother going to zero, And the accuracy is also probably a little bit smoother, going to one. So the question is, of course, is there a benefit with gating? And we'll explore that a little bit more when we'll have a look at the code. So in the last part of this lesson, we'll discuss more elaborate recurrent network architecture, namely LSTM and gated recurrent unit. So these are recurrent neural networks with more parameters. So you have they are more expressive. They are designed in order to deal with what is called the problem of long-term dependencies, which is described in this blog. So meaning that you want sometimes to keep information far away from where you are in order to do a prediction. So for example, in the parenthesis case, you probably need to remember the very first parenthesis. If you close all the intermediary parentheses in your sequence, so there are some sequences which require to keep a memory of what happened a long time in the past. They are also designed in order to mitigate the so-called vanishing gradient problem. So here, the problem is you can see it very easily. If you are using, as I said, hypertangent a function for nonlinearity, which are those mostly used for a recurrent neural network, you see that the gradient of this function is between 0 and 1. And now if you have a long sequence, you will multiply, you will have a lot of hyperbolic tangent applied to your sequence. And when you are backpropagating the gradient, you will multiply each time your current gradient by something which is between 0 and 1. So you see that your gradient will vanish when you are reaching the beginning of your sequence. So this is what is called a vanishing gradient, and we'll see that gating allows you to mitigate this problem. So there are state-of-the-art architecture in many learning problems, and it's very easy to use multi-layer recurrent neural networks. So this is depicted on this image here. So again, you have your input in red here, with the time going from left to right. And what we called a multi-layer recurrent neural network is when you pass directly this input to your first layer of recurrent neural network. So each recurrent neural network here is computing a hidden state, which is passed horizontally here. But this hidden state is also passed as the input of the second layer of your recurrent neural network, and third one, and so on. So you see that the hidden state is going in this direction, but also in this vertical direction. Now there is a hidden state going in this direction, and then pass through the next layer, and so on. And at the end, here, what you will use to make your prediction is the output of your last layer. So this is an unrolled representation of three layers of recurrent neural networks. So here is a formal description of gated recurrent unit, where you see in blue basically what we have done so far. So again, a forget gate over there. Now you have one modification, which is in the computation of the candidate for your new hidden state. Okay. Where you have this so-called reset gate, and the reset gate is again something between 0 and 1 with new parameters, but the same kind of structure as the forget gate. And this will allow you to use or not the previous hidden state in the computation of your candidate for the new hidden state. So if you R of t is equal to 1, this is exactly what we saw before. And now the last point is that the new hidden state is just a linear combination of a weighted linear combination of the previous hidden state and your new candidate, where the weight is computed by this forget gate. So this was proposed a few years ago in this paper by Chou et al. So here is a simple picture corresponding exactly to this equation, which are exactly this notation, but in a compact form. For example, this is a concatenation of the hidden state and the new incoming state. So this reset gate RT is exactly this equation over there, which is more explicit. Same thing for ZT, the new candidate for your hidden state, and finally the hidden state computed by your gated recurrent unit. So here you have the previous hidden state coming into the cell on the left here, the new information coming at the bottom over there. So based on these two inputs, you are computing first the reset gate and the forget gate, ZT. And you are using this reset gate and this forget gate in order to compute your candidate for the new hidden state, and finally your new hidden state here, which is passed to the next cell at the same layer, and also to the layer upwards if you want to use multiple layers of gated recurrent unit. So here is a picture of the LSTM architecture. So you see that it's quite amazing, but they were proposed quite a long time ago by Hochreiter and Schmidhuber. So there is one main modification compared to the gated recurrent unit. Namely, there is a new notion, a notion of cell states. So the cell state will remain at a given layer and grow across all the sequence. And of course, there is also a hidden state, and the hidden state will also go across the layer, but will be sent also to the upward layer and to the output. So this is the main modification of LSTM. And then you have still a few gates. So the first one, which is called the forget gate layer, which take as input previous hidden state and the new incoming information and pass it through a sigmoid. Now you have what is called the input gate layer, which takes the same input and compute a new real number between 0 and 1. And this C tilde is your new candidate for your new cell state, which is again based on the same input, but now passed through a hyperbolic tangent. So far we didn't use the input gate and forget gate, so this is done here. So you see that the new cell state is now a combination of the previous cell state multiplied by the forget gate and the new candidate multiplied by the input gate, this one. So you see that it's not anymore a function f1 minus f, it's just a weighted sum with two weights which are learned. This f of t and I of t are between 0 and 1, but they do not have to sum to 1. So this is the explanation for what's happening to the cell state, and now you need to define also what's happening to your hidden state. So you have a last gate, which is called the output gate, which always takes the same input, hidden state at previous timestamp on the new incoming information. You pass it through a sigmoid layer. And now the hidden state is just this new output gate state times a nonlinearity applied to the cell state, hyperbolic tangent. So if you want to use it in PyTorch, you don't have to code everything. So there is a layer which is in the torch.nn library, which is LSTM, which is doing exactly what you want to. So here is one simple example. So you have your whole net LSTM cell is defined over there. So you can define a number of layers also. So you can stack different layers over there. You need to define a dimension for the input, so for the x of t, and for the hidden state. Now you have to get familiar with this LSTM in PyTorch. You have to look at the documentation. In particular, there is one thing which is a bit surprising. By default, the batch size is the second value of your the second coordinate of your input. So it's not batch size, sex, length, and dimension recurrent. It's this shape over there that is expected as input. So you can change this if you want. Also, we are not dealing with batches in this lesson. You see that these LSTM cells are built in order to use batches. So in our particular case, this is why I'm adding an unsqueeze one here, because my network is expecting the second dimension to correspond to the size of the batch. So here it's a batch of size one. And similarly here for the output, I'm squeezing it. So I'm removing this dimension in order to pass it through the last layer. So here are the examples, are the results for this LSTM. So in green we have NMAN, in orange we have gated RNN, and in blue this is the last one, this is the LSTM, so this is the loss. So you see that it's a loss, it's a bit harder to decrease to zero, it's not very smooth. And the performance also, in terms of accuracy, it starts with much worse performance than previous algorithm. And then stabilize to one with one gap. So, I mean, given these results, you might wonder why using such complicated architecture. And we will answer to this question in a moment. But before that, here is the common wisdom in 2015. So this paper conducted extensive exploration of different recurrent architectures. So as you have seen, this lesson is a little bit like a fairy tale. You need to see the performance of your algorithm in order to believe that they are working. It's quite hard to get convinced with only high-level argument as the one I gave here. So this is what they have done in this paper, and they show that basically LSTM and GRU are architecture which are consistently giving very good performances on a lot of different tasks. So now it's time to check if what I've said so far is true or not by looking at this code.